Some people are very excited you're here. Some of you apparently your coffee's still kicking in, but we'll give it a minute. It's okay. A couple of announcements to start off this week. Next week is Easter Sunday. We are doing a sunrise service at 9. Our justification for that is that, the sun will be up before 9, but by the time the fog lifts, you can actually see it. It'll probably be 9. So that's what we're going. We'll do a short service at 9 o'clock next Sunday morning here. And then we'll have a meal that some of our men are putting together, and it's going to be good, delicious, and excited about that. Another thing to announce, we've got a letter in the mail. Our Scioto Valley Baptist Association annual meeting is April the 10th. It's in Chillicothe. So just a brief update. The association has been working to figure out what they look like for the future and what the association is going to be and how it's going to be directed. And they've had a team that's been working for a year that will give a report. Let me just tell you what they are saying is going on. There will be reports from Jack Helton, who has been our interim director. There will be a report from Ministry Council and the Revitalization Team, as well as reports from Reginald Hayes, who is the pastoral president of the State Convention, Buzz Kotcher, who is part of North American Missions Board, and a new church planner from Ohio University. So that's what will be going on. If anyone is interested in going, please contact me. We can send representatives. I don't know that there will be any deal of voting going on, but it would be good for us to at least send a representative because we are still a part of the association. So with that being the case, that's April the 10th coming up, but in any case. I will remind us in the midst of our announcements here this morning that we are in the middle of Annie Armstrong. Yes, Annie Armstrong. I always get Annie Armstrong and Lottie Moon backwards. My brain is... And just to remind you that if we raise $2,000 of dedicated funds, including next Sunday, Denver and I will dress up as Looney Tunes characters and go through the park. So that is your incentive to see a deacon and a pastor do something that would be rather foolish, I reckon, under other circumstances, but anything to help people hear the Word of God. So just to remind you of that. Right. At this time, we're going to do our catechism question. We are on question 13, and so I will ask you to stand for this because we'll jump right into the songs immediately following. And it is, media team is just spot on. You're good. Question 13. I'll read the question and then we all read the answer together. Can anyone keep the law of God perfectly? Since the fall, no mere human has been able to keep the law of God perfectly, but consistently breaks it in thought, word, and deed. Romans 3:10 says, none is righteous, no, not one. No one understands nor seeks for God. All have turned aside. Together they have become worthless, and no one does good, not even one. This question reminds us, as Sanders so aptly pointed out, that nope, we struggle with the law, don't we? We struggle with doing what is right even when we know and have the ability to do so. But praise God that Jesus did and does what is perfect and right. And because of that, we can be good and belong to the Father.
This is taken from Matthew chapter 26, verse 26 through 29. Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, take it, take, eat, this is my body. And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.
All right, we're going to go to page 246.
Yeah.
means a lot to me. Even in the hardest days when I don't think I'm good enough, God is holding on to me, and that's because of what Jesus did, and that he sent his son to die for us. So we're going to sing about that. Excuse me, water first.
Sunday before Easter, the Sunday before the resurrection of Christ historically in the church. And there's a reason it's called Palm Sunday. It's not because everybody gives extra high fives. It's Palm. Was that pun too lowbrow to start a sermon with? Palm. Okay, I'm sorry. I'll try again next week. And it's called Palm Sunday because the week before Christ's resurrection, he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey. And do you remember what they did as he rode into town? They shouted Hosanna at the highest, and they laid palm branches on the ground so that even the feet of the steed he rode in on wouldn't touch the dirt of the earth. Think about what an honor that would be for a man such as Christ. Think about the glory that would have been. And then think about the reality of these same people who on Sunday cried Hosanna in the highest and laid palm branches at the feet of the animal on which Jesus rode would then yell, kill him, 5 days later. We celebrate Palm Sunday for a reason. And the reason is it shows the coming of our Lord. In the same way that he rode into Israel, knowing the cup of wrath would be poured out on him. Knowing that by week's end, he would have been nailed and hung to a cross to die of suffocation and blood loss. He did so for our sake. And yet he rode into town anyway. It's the same week in which he would have the Passover meal with his disciples, of which our call to worship came from this morning. And we'll deal with that in more of the sermon. But what I want to do for our sake is to look at Exodus chapter 12, the original Passover, the first Passover. The Passover that points forward and foreshadows to what we read about this morning and what we will deal with in great detail next week. So with that being said, we're going to read verses 1 through 14 of Exodus chapter 12, and I will ask you to stand for the reading of God's Word. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall be for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. To all the congregation of Israel, that on the 10th day of this month, every man shall take a lamb according to their father's houses, a lamb for a household. And if the household is too small for a lamb, then he and his nearest neighbor shall take according to the number of persons, according to what each can eat. You shall make your count for the lamb. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a male a year old. You shall take it from the sheep or from the goats, and you shall keep it until the 14th day of this month, when the whole assembly of the congregation of Israel shall kill their lambs at twilight. Then they shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintel of the houses in which they eat it. They shall eat the flesh that night, roasted on the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. They shall eat it. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roasted, its head with its legs and its inner parts. You shall let none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until the morning you shall burn. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened, and your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike all the firstborn in the land of Egypt, both man and beast, and on all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on your house where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will befall you to destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be for you a memorial day, and you shall keep it as a feast to the Lord throughout your generations, as a statute forever. You shall keep it as a feast." God, I ask this morning that you would speak to your people, that we would, in our efforts to know and study your word, would glorify you, that we would see your gracious, loving kindness and your mercy poured out on these pages, and that, God, we would grow closer together in you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. I have 3 points here that I kind of want to deal with, but this is about the true Passover, not necessarily what happened in Egypt all those many years ago. So let's deal with the first thing, events leading up to the Passover. I mean, we can't deal with just this on its own. It exists in a place and a time. We know that there have been 9 other plagues that God had sent to Egypt for their punishment of Israel. We know that Israel has been in Egypt, particularly the land of Giza, for roughly 400 years since the time of Joseph and his brothers. And we know that they have been slaves. We know the pyramids are built upon the blood, sweat, and tears and lives of God's people, the Israelites. We know that that is the scenario in which we find these Israelites. We know of Moses. So I won't summarize Moses and Aaron too much to you, but know that Moses was born and raised in an Egyptian household by Pharaoh, and then upon murdering an Egyptian, fled, and he hid from God, and he hid from God's people. It is there that God sought out Moses, spoke to him miraculously through a burning bush, and called him for a specific purpose and gave him Aaron to be a mouthpiece for him. So the Passover then is really the setup to the final plague, the final show of God's glory, the final show of God revealing himself in amazing might and splendor to Egypt, which would have been the capital of the world in its day. And it is in this context that we see what is taking place with the Passover. We know that routinely with every plague, Pharaoh would be repentant, and he would desire to let the people go, God's people go, or even to some degree. And then he would go back on his offer, and he would command them to stay under threat of violence. Since Adam, God has been working towards redeeming his people to himself. And this is the continuation of that. There's a reason in verse 14 that it says that this will be a memorial day for generations to come. It's because for generations, God's people would glorify God through the Passover meal. They would look to God redeeming them and saving them out of slavery in Egypt. This is a point of national pride, national identity, national significance for Israel. They are who they are because what God did for them out of Egypt by saving them and redeeming them from slavery. And because of this, we see here, even in the very essence of the Passover meal, this institution, I know we think we love Christmas, right? We love our holidays. 4th of July is one of the biggest holidays in American history. It's fundamental to our identity that we are free because of the bravery of some men to stand up to tyranny. That is part of our American identity. But the reality is that I think, pales in comparison to what the Passover was to Israel's identity. We see that Israel is in bondage, and they were only freed by the grace of God. We see in this Passover meal that God saved them. Right? The final plague, the 10th plague, was the destroyer came into Egypt, came into this place. It is called the destroyer in the second half of chapter 12. And that destroyer was sent by God to kill the firstborn of every man, every family, and even of all the livestock. Every firstborn died, including Pharaoh's son. Now, this would have happened to the Israelites too had not God given them instructions. Part of that instruction was that for every house, a lamb was to be taken. And this lamb was to be killed. And this lamb's blood was, with a branch of hyssop, to be put on the lintel and the doorpost of the house as a marking and as a sign. That is how the destroyer knew to pass over that house. That's where Passover comes from. It's because God's judgment against sin passed over the houses of the Israelites. And so we see that God shows the world that he is the one and only true God. Imagine if this took place today. Imagine if the ten plagues happened in modern Egypt. Right? The blocking of the Suez Canal has been all over the news this past week. I don't know if you've heard of it. I have. I've watched it. I've been fascinated by it. This gigantic shipping vessel that is just enormously huge got a little sideways and blocked the Suez Canal. And it's reportedly it had like a $10 billion effect on the economy. But it's been all over the news. And imagine how that would pale in comparison if in Egypt right now, God was showing his glory and might through the 10 plagues. Every reporter and camera on the planet would be in Egypt and not focused on some sideways shipping container in the canal down in the middle of Americas. God is showing through these 10 plagues that he alone is God, and that he has the righteousness and the perfect justice to do as he has done through every plague, even the death of the firstborn in every family. And so we see these events leading up to the Passover. We see that God is building. We know that God did this to show his might and his glory and to redeem his people. But we know now that the Passover was not an end to itself. In fact, it was a means to other ends. We know that after the Passover, after God took the firstborn of every house and every livestock in Egypt, We know that Israel was freed. They took with them and they left Egypt. And then they wandered the desert for 40 years in their sinfulness. Then after 40 years, they finally made their way to the Promised Land. They made their way to Canaan. And we know that they had some prosperity there for a number of years. But if you've read the book of Judges, you know their history. It was, they got really sinful. Then God would send them a judge and they'd repent and they'd become obedient and faithful to God again. And then that generation would pass away and then more sin would take place. And then God would send another judge and they'd be faithful and obedient again. And that just happens over and over and over and over and over through the book of Judges. And then we get into the historical parts of Samuel and David and all of those guys that take place. And then we see the Exodus. We see them drawn out and captive in slavery again in Persia, which is the time of Esther as we were studying. So we know that the Passover is not the end, but it means towards another end. We know that through all those generations between Egypt and the days of Jesus under the Roman occupation, they continued to hold the Passover. They continued to be reminded of this meal, this memorial that was an inherent part of their identity. And so what we see then is that the original Passover, while immensely significant because it marks and memorializes God freeing his people from slavery, actually foreshadowed something else. It pointed forward to something else. See, all of Israel in Egypt was slaves. They were slaves held in captivity against their will to do grueling, back-breaking labor, even unto death. And while the Passover immensely memorialized God's grace freeing them from that, it actually points forward. And so I think the first thing it really foreshadows of is of Christ in the Passover. So let's look at this again and see here that God was not done with Egypt. God was not done with Israel in Egypt. Right? We know that God made promises to Abraham and to Isaac and their offspring to give them a land, the land of Canaan, that was flowing with milk and honey. It was a beautiful land. It would be good for them that they could grow old in and be a growing power in. And then Joseph and his brothers and sisters and their descendants wound up in Israel as slaves. Well, God wasn't done with Israel, even when it was just Israel, that is Jacob. He wasn't done with them when they wound up slaves in Egypt for centuries. He wasn't done with them even when they were in Canaan flourishing and then going into sin over and over again. We know that God wasn't done with Egypt, with Israel, even when they were in Persia, when they were held captives and carried off as slaves from Israel for their disobedience and their sin. No, God was continuing to work, building up to the moment Christ came into the world. God has been working from Adam to Jesus and will work from Jesus back to his second coming in the final judgment. But we see Jesus all over this passage, don't we? I hope when you look at it, you do. You will today. So we see that every household is to take a lamb that is a year old, and a lamb without blemish. Now, who else have we heard called a lamb led to slaughter? A silent lamb that doesn't bleat, doesn't hay or anything like that, but humbly goes before the slaughter. I won't tell you. I will let you assume. We'll come back to it. But we do see this lamb, the lamb that is perfect without blemish, that is to be sacrificed. Now, why is this lamb to be sacrificed? So that its blood can be put on the entryway of the home. Now, why do they have to put the blood on the entryway of the home? So that the Spirit of God coming for destruction would pass over that home. So that blood then is the marker, the signifier of salvation. It says that the people in this house belong to God. They are God's people. Now, where does that make you think? What, does that not sound familiar? That the blood of this lamb slaughtered and poured out, wiped on the doorposts of this home, signifies belonging to God. This lamb must be perfect. It must be a male. It must be taken from the herds that belong to Israel. The blood on the lintels and the doorposts. This is crucially important because it points forward. They are to eat it with unleavened bread. We do know from later passages through the Old Testament that they would have it with certain wine. We know that that would grow into what is known as the Seder feast, the feast of the Passover meal, in which they would have wine, and they would have unleavened bread, and they would have bitter herbs with it, and they would have a lamb, a male, a year old, without blemish, roasted over fire with all of its parts, and none of it would be left till morning. This should sound familiar from Matthew 26 as we read this morning. This is incredibly important because this foreshadows, this points forward to Jesus. Think about this. And as Jesus is the week before his death, he's having the Passover meal with his disciples, and he takes the unleavened bread up off the table, and he looks them in the eye and says, "This is my body broken for you." That is inherently part of this Passover meal. Think about the lamb's body was sacrificed. It was broken so that the people in the household could be saved. The blood of the lamb was shed so that judgment for sin, because ultimately that is why God cast judgment on Egypt, was for their sin, that God's judgment for sin would pass over those who belong to the blood or who are marked by the blood. Now think about this. I guarantee you there were some less than appealing people of Israel who had blood on their doorposts. There were probably some scuzzy people who had blood on their doorposts. People who we think, they weren't good Christian people. They were not good Jews. They did not follow the law. They were not obedient. And yet, do you think that for 1 second the Spirit of God ignored the blood on the doorposts? Of course not. Because that blood signifies something important. It doesn't say, hey, the people in this house are really great, morally upstanding people. They're faithful Jews. They attend Mass. No, it says they belong to the Lamb. And that supersedes and goes above and beyond anything that we could ever do morally. The foreshadowing of the Passover points to Jesus. We are marked by the blood and saved from the judgment of God by the grace of that Lamb. The other part that this points forward to Jesus in the same way is that the way in which Israelites were supposed to eat this meal. Now, does it say in the passage that they got out their recliner and set their pillow on their lap and their plate on the pillow with their shoes off and in their comfy sweatpants? Because you know when you eat a big meal, you have to have sweatpants on, right? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Right? Like, we all know this. Like, the proper Thanksgiving attire is not a suit and a belt. It's stretching pants. Right? We know this, right? Is that how they were supposed to eat it? No. Instead, verse 8, they shall eat the flesh that night, roasted with fire. Verse 9, 10. Where am I at? Verse 11. I don't see. Verse 11. In this manner you shall eat it, with your belt fastened around you, your sandals on your feet, your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it in haste. Now, why are they told to eat it in haste? Think about this. The spirit of death and destruction was going to be passing over the land. How on earth could they ever possibly sit down and relax and eat a meal? Right? That's like living in Nebraska in tornado season, and there's like F5 tornadoes circling your house, and there's cows flying by the window. It's Wizard of Oz. It's just tragedy strikes everywhere. 2x4s flying in the wind, and you're just at your table having dinner. Like, imagine how much more dangerous the Spirit of God can be than any tornado. And yet that's the scene that is set before us, that here they are in their homes. They just smeared blood on their door and they're eating lamb while death reigns over top of them. It makes sense then that they would eat it ready to go. It's not because it's scary that they have to eat with their belt around their waist and their shoes on their feet and their staff in their hand. It's because when the Spirit of God passes over and death comes for the Egyptians, they've got to be ready to get out of Dodge. Because the time for them to leave slavery is upon them. They should not be caught lazy and unawares. They should be caught ready to go. Think about this. They were slaves. They were sojourners in the land of Egypt. They weren't Egyptians. They were not like the people around them. They were Israelites. They were different. They were set apart for a purpose. And because of this, when it finally came time for them to be saved from slavery and saved from bondage and saved from their oppressors, God's command to them is to eat this meal, to be marked by the blood of the Lamb, and have your shoes on your feet ready to go. This foreshadows us as well. It foreshadows towards to Christ. Because Christ says in John 18 that we are not of this world. That his kingdom is not of this world. That we are sojourners. Even today, being where we are as Christians, we are sojourners. Our identity should be more in Christ and the blood of the Lamb than it should be that we are American. To say that God has a special relationship with America is to spit in the face of every Christian from every other country. It doesn't mean we don't celebrate the freedoms and the joys we have. Absolutely we should, because they are a gift from God. But hear me now, if you wear the name of Christ, you belong more to the kingdom of heaven than you do to any country on this earth. Celebrate the freedoms, yes, absolutely. Be glad that God has blessed us to live where we do, because it is a blessing. But realize that as Christians, we are more like Israelites that are slaves in Egypt than we are the Egyptians. We are not the natives. We are not locals. We are of another nation, sent here as sojourners, called to live with our shoes on our feet and our belt around our waist and our staff in our hand, ready to go. Everyone I've talked to here that has been through dark moments longed for the days in which we can go to heaven, longed for time with Jesus. And I tell you, when we get to heaven, whether it be all at once or one at a time, it will be relaxing. Right? Think about that. I mean, that's not something people normally talk about when they go to heaven, is it? We talk about the glory of God and the celebratory feast and seeing long-lost loved ones we haven't heard from in years. But at the same time, when we're at heaven, when we are in heaven with God, think about the utter lack of stress and worry. You'll be able to relax in a manner and a way that is impossible on this earth. And I'm not saying we should make an idol out of relaxation. We absolutely shouldn't. But one of the under-talked about aspects of heaven is that we'll finally be able to think about the first exhale in heaven. They say controlled breathing helps you relax and get your everything back under rhythm and in control. Think about that first breath of heavenly air. Just gives me goosebumps thinking about it. But we are sojourners in a foreign land here. We are not natives. Think about this. The people, the Israelites who would have lived through the Ten Commandments, were born in Egypt. They were raised in Egypt. Their parents and their grandparents and their grandparents, they were there for 400 years. Generations of Israelites were born in Egypt. Now just for scale, just for the scope of things. Israel was in Egypt as slaves longer than America has been a country. Significantly longer. We here are sojourners, called to be ready, desiring to go to the true kingdom of which we belong. That is why Israel was to eat this meal in haste, to be ready to go. And likewise, we are to do things here, focused on the Lamb, focused on Christ, knowing that this is not our home. This is not where we will be forever. This is not permanent for us. This is temporary. We are sojourners in this land, longing to go home. Christ is our only hope against God's judgment. Think about this. The Israelites were not saved because they were morally right. They were not saved because they were perfect. They are not saved because they were good. Nobody is good. Nobody seeks after God's goodness. But the reality is that they were saved because of the blood of the Lamb. They were saved by God's grace. God did not have to tell them how to survive this. And yet God desired redemption, and he does desire redemption, and he was working, even from the time of Adam to Christ, for redemption. And so Israel wasn't saved because they did the right thing or because they put the blood on the doorpost, but because the blood was on the doorpost. They were saved because God had grace and mercy on them and because the blood was there. They were saved by the act and the will of God to pass over the houses with the blood on the door. We likewise are deeply flawed and imperfect. We have sin. We are guilty of our sin. Christ is our only hope against God's judgment for our sins. In the same way that Israel had to put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, we are marked by the blood of Jesus, because the blood of Jesus is the only thing that will keep the judgment of God from coming into our house. Christ is our only hope against God's judgment. The final aspect of this I want to deal with is that Christ is the true Israel. Christ, Jesus is the true Israel. And there's half of what Jesus said in the New Testament and the Gospels explains this, but I want to deal with this out of here. Jesus was suffered. He suffered and was tempted in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4. Right? He suffered. He was tempted. And even in the wilderness, he did not fall to temptation. He did not fail or give in to temptation. Israel wandered in the wilderness for 40 years and seemed to give in to every temptation that came across them. But Jesus never gave in to temptation, even in wilderness. In the same way that the lamb's blood allowed for God to pass over judging Israel and went to others, Jesus' blood atones for our sins. And this is real salvation from bondage. Think about where we find Israel when Jesus comes to town. They are once again under the thumb and occupation of another world superpower. It may not be Egypt this time, it was Rome. But Israel's been under the subjugation of Egypt, of Persia, of the Medes, and even Rome. And that just is between the time of Abraham and Jesus. His blood atones for our sin. And this means real salvation from bondage. God saved Israel out of slavery in Egypt, and yet they found themselves as slaves again. So obviously that salvation wasn't the real salvation, but a foreshadowing. It points forward, not just to worldly slavery, but slavery to sin. This is the real slavery that we face outside of Christ. Sin has its grip. It's ingrained into us. We struggle with it and we fight with it, even if we acknowledge it. Many are so deeply ingrained with sin that they don't even know they have something to fight. They just think it's part of life. They think it's natural and normal for those sins to take place. That's how we wound up with the world we're in today, in which sin is rampant. It's not because people hate God, it's because sin is so ingrained into them that that's just humanity. They've made peace with their sin. They've let the bear live in their house. Israel was saved from slavery through Christ, Jesus being the true Israel. Salvation isn't from worldly slavery, it's from slavery to sin. We are no longer held accountable for our sins if we are marked by the blood of the Lamb. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount that he came not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law. Now, let's understand what the law is. Right, when Jesus says the law, really in the Bible, when you see the law and the prophets, it's talking about the Old Testament. Now, think about what is contained in the Old Testament. It's not just do's and don'ts. It's the promises of God. And what is the great promise of God? That we can be saved by the blood of the Son. That he would send a Savior through which we could be saved. Think about this. This goes all the way back to Genesis 3. God told Eve that her offspring would crush the head of the serpent, the great tempter, the one who led others into sin. And so if the offspring of Eve would then crush the tempter, that is at least a metaphor that God promises to send one who will defeat sin. So if Jesus then says that he is not to abolish the law, but to fulfill the law, that's him saying that he is the fulfillment of God's promises. Think about what hope I just said out loud. That God promises to crush sin and to redeem us and to save us, and that Jesus is the fulfillment of that promise. We ought to be more excited about such things. Jesus is the fulfillment of God's promises to save us from ourselves. Think about the Last Supper. If Jesus is not God's fulfillment of promises, if he is not God's atoning work for God's people, then what he says in the Last Supper is a lie and he's a heretic and should wrongly be banished for his false beliefs. But the reality is his body was broken and his blood was poured out as the fulfillment of God's promises to save us. Jesus is the true Israel. He is, because Israel was not just a people unto themselves. They were not a means towards their own end, but God's intended purpose to save and redeem all people through Jesus. That is the purpose of Israel, is that Jesus, our salvation, would come into the world through them as God promised. And so if Israel is the means by which God helps people and saves people, then the true Israel is Christ, the Messiah, promised to come to offer redemption and salvation into the world. This is the season of Lent that we are in. It's not a lack of other things, but a focus on Christ. Easter being next week, we celebrate the resurrection, yes, but the resurrection doesn't exist in a vacuum. It is not its own thing. In fact, it points us to salvation. It points us to Jesus. The resurrection is our hope. It is the fulfillment of God's promises that it really happened. It really took place. And we sit and we nod and we wonder. The Passover meal, the Passover event in Exodus points forward to Jesus. Jesus is our hope. This is what we celebrate in the midst of Easter. It's not that God would just forgive us our sins, but that we could know God. That God would fulfill his promises, that he would be faithful to such ends. This should stir us up. This should move us to action. This should cause us to put our shoes on our feet and our staff in our hand, remembering that we're sojourners here, we are working for a true king. We belong somewhere else. The resurrection points us to an eternal heaven. We aren't saved to be good people. In fact, if we are, many of us, myself foremost among, are failing at it. We aren't saved to be good. We are saved because Christ loved us enough to redeem us in the midst of our awfulness. Even in the very darkest, evilest things you've ever thought and done, God still desired to save you from that. Let us remember that grace this week as we walk into the Easter season, being reminded that the resurrection is not a thing in and of itself or unto itself, but that it points us to the glory of God and salvation of sinful men like me. God, I'm thankful for this time to spend together here, to look at your word, to be mindful and considerate of the grace that you have poured out for us in the blood of your Son. Lord, we know that those Passover lambs so many years ago were slain so that you might practice grace and mercy on your people. And Lord, we know that points us to the true Lamb who was slain that we might find immense, never-ending grace and mercy in you. Lord, I am humbled. I'm humbled by your grace. God, that you would look at an awful sinner such as myself, even in the midst of my worst sins. Lord, that you would still redeem and save. Lord, that you would look on people who have rejected you and denied you and walked away from you, and that you would hold them fast, even when we may not feel as though we are good or deserve it. God, even when we might be tempted to walk away, you have held us fast and will continue to do so until the day of perfection. It's in your name we hope and we pray.
Please stand. We're going to sing this last song, page 162.
Bible study. We're continuing David Jeremiah series on, is the whole series on prayer? It's on prayer. I know it's something I need to spend some more time in studying and doing. I look forward to that. It's a good time. And then Wednesday night, we'll have our Bible study continuing through Esther. Next Sunday, we'll have our summary service at 9. We will be taking communion in that service, so spend some time this week in prayer and deliberating on what it means to take communion. And we'll spend the time worshiping the Lord. Debbie, can I ask you to pray for us?
Dear Heavenly Father, once again we come, your people, and our students, dear Lord, knowing that you are here with us in your hands. Forgive us, Lord, for we fall short. Help us to remember that you are the Almighty and you can bring us out of anything that we are in. We thank you for the season that we are going to be. We are going to be rejoicing in this next week, dear Lord, coming up Friday, the loss of your son, dear Lord, that you gave him for us, his blood for our salvation. Let the people know that your Heavenly Father, the people who are walking around endlessly, let them know, dear Lord, you are there to teach our message. Have us throughout our week, forgive us for any sin before others, dear Lord.